Welcome to the show, everybody.
Now, you know, throughout history, we've constantly changed our image of the ideal feminine beauty. Over the last centuries, the plump and soft Rubenesque women was every man's fantasy. In the 1960s, though, the anorexic Twiggy look was considered sexy. In the fitness-crazed 1970s and 80s, women wanted that toned and tight physique. Now, have we gone one step beyond all that? Is this the ideal woman of the 1990s? Diana. Janet. Erica. Linda. Laura.
Strike the pose.
Wow.
Strike the pose.
What do you say? Let me introduce our female bodybuilders here. This is Diana Dennis. She's the 37-year-old mother of two, and matter of fact, her 20-year-old son, Ken, joins us in our front row. Now, Diana, how does your son feel having a mom who's in better shape than he is?
Ask him.
Well, how do you feel?
I don't look at his. She's just my mom.
Just mom, oh, I don't know, it's a different image of mom, and a lovely one, too. This is Janet Tech. She's 32 years old. She was the 1980 world champion bodybuilder. Like Diana, she's preparing for the Ms. Olympia competition in November. Now, before getting into bodybuilding, you were a ballerina?
I studied ballet and modern dance. That was the 88 world championships.
Now, I think of ballet dancers as being, you know, they have muscular legs, it's true, for all the leaping and pirouetting and everything else, but their tops and the rest of them, very, very willowy and feminine. Was it hard to make the transition?
Very hard. That is the main reason why I started training, to get a better upper body to match my lower body.
Love your outfit.
Thank you.
What little of it that we see there. this voluptuous and lovely lady, Erica Andersch from where?
I grew up in New Hampshire, of German descent.
Of German descent, New Hampshire. Okay, now she started training as a bodybuilder 5 years ago. Now, her new body, because she's a bodybuilder, won her a spot on that the crash TV show American Gladiators. You ever see that one? I see how, you know, you really knock each other around on that. Now, you go against some just plain old civilian women. Do you ever feel like a bully?
Well, it took me a couple of weeks to get used to it, and then I had to feel like a bully or else they would bully me.
I mean, just an exquisite, you know, package there. This is Linda Murray. She's a former professional cheerleader. She's been a professional bodybuilder for the past 7 years. Now, I think of cheerleaders a lot like ballet as kind of the ideal of femininity. Do you think that bodybuilding is the opposite of cheerleading?
No, actually, the cheerleading helped a great deal with the bodybuilding because you have to be able to perform in front of an audience. It helps me with choreographing my routines, and it gave me a strong upper body. So when I got involved in bodybuilding, actually, it worked well together.
Well, I must say, I have never seen a cheerleader with arms like these. I mean, look at those biceps. I mean, I'm beginning to feel like a 98-pound weakling up here. This is Laura Craval, okay. She's the current Ms. International. Now, did you ever work so hard at looking good? Because I know it's an insular kind of thing. You've got to be in the gym, you've got to be pumping up, that you thought, well, that you even made yourself sick.
No, I don't really train that much. I train like an hour and a half a day, and I do like an hour aerobics, so I'm not one of those people that spend forever in the gym. I like to train, but I like to rest a lot, so I enjoy it. I really enjoy it, and I enjoy the results. And when I go to gym And I come home, and after a couple of weeks, I start seeing how my body changed. I get so psyched, I just keep on going.
Now, one thing, you have very little body fat on your exquisite torso there. Does that, do you sacrifice sometime upper body, do you sacrifice breasts, let me just say it, for muscles?
In the first place, I never had big boobs. breasts, to a certain extent, it is body fat. So when you get lean, you do, you know, sacrifice some breasts, but I prefer to sacrifice a breast than instead of being fat.
Erica, on the other hand, I noticed you didn't quite make that sacrifice. Now, how did you manage that?
Erica got lucky.
Okay, now, we're going to talk to these ladies. We're going to talk to them about what they do. We're going to talk to them about the men in their lives, ask them about things varying from sex to sweat to stigma to steroids. It's an inside look into the world of women bodybuilders. That's the focus of this edition of Geraldo. You can all get changed, and we'll sit down and have a conversation. Inside the world of the woman bodybuilders, their bodies are pumped up, toned, and ripped. These women could probably handle a barbell better than most physically fit men. I know they could handle it better than I can, for example. But they'll tell you, I think, that they haven't lost any of their femininity. Here they are, for example, in civilian clothes. Come on out, ladies. Here's Diana again. Look at that. Terrific. Come on out. Is Janet. Janet's going to work out. So she's there. Is Erica. Lovely Erica. Linda. Nice dress. Sweater. And Laura, you know, I'm struck. Get a shot of Linda there. She puts her microphone on with that beautiful, feminine, lovely outfit. And then look at the poster shot behind. Looks like, you know, just tilt up there. There it is. Look at that. I mean, look at those thighs, those legs. Incredible. we are also joined, let me introduce Carla Dunlop. Now, Carla started competing in bodybuilding in 1979. She has several times won the Ms. Olympia contest. Now, Carla, as the other ladies put their microphone on, are men ever intimidated by your physique?
I think that many men who are not in shape or who have insecurities that would be pointed up either by a woman's aggressiveness or assertiveness or any other thing, her brains or intelligence, are the ones who are intimidated by a woman who is physically fit. But any man that is very secure and knows what he wants is hardly intimidated by something like this.
What about a guy that's got a pot belly, or what about a guy who's skinny?
He might be, but he'd be intimidated by the guy next to him who's got washboard abs.
You know, looking again at Linda's photograph, Ken Cooper, her boyfriend, sits in front of her. Now, Ken, it seems to me that, do you ever feel that you get out of line, she's going to, like, whip your ass?
No, not at all.
You work together, right?
Yeah.
You help her pump up?
Yeah.
Is she in better shape than you are?
Leading question.
No.
I won't press that one. Carolyn Weber here is a freelance journalist. She's also a bodybuilder. She began lifting weights when she was 39 years old. So, you know, I guess you don't have to start as a kid.
No, absolutely not. Anyone can start at any age, literally.
Do you think that many people have a kind of stereotype in their head that women bodybuilders are kind of female heads on top of male bodies?
Yeah, that's definitely a stereotype, and we're here today to disprove that. I think the women that came out earlier, we were sitting in the green room, and we just went, yeah, you guys look great. And I think they look very womanly, and I don't think they look like men with female heads on them at all.
Let's get some questions.
I think you all look very well. I'm physically embarrassed, but I would like to ask the question, who inspired you and at what age were you inspired?
Erica, let's ask, who in New Hampshire inspired you?
Well, actually, I inspired myself because I like the feeling of going to the gym. I'm a strong girl and very active. And then my husband, Brian, inspired me to train, and he's been training me for the past 5 years.
Brian is here, too, yeah. Right in the front row there. Now, Brian, you are or were a bodybuilder, right?
That's correct.
Are you the fellow that had the injury?
Yes, my career had ended just before the USA. I had an accident where I'd broken my neck.
Oh, my goodness.
Because of the physical conditioning I was in, I was able to survive and through a period of time be able to get back into shape to compete, hopefully next year or the year after.
In the meantime, you're training Erica?
That's correct.
How has it affected your relationship, the fact that she has become so strong?
It hasn't changed our relationship. That's still very strong, and, you know, we're husband and wife, and we're a team. I support her 100%, whatever she wants to do. I'm not pushing her to do this. Aside from that, really, things haven't changed. It's very busy.
Any kids, Erica?
Yes.
How many?
We have 3 children.
And what's the age range?
12, 10, and 5.
Would you, boys or girls?
2 boys and a girl.
How old's the girl?
12. She's the eldest.
Does she bodybuild?
No, I wouldn't. You know,
you would
not
never
the children.
Uh-huh. Encourage her? Why not?
Not the children. Well, when they're older, perhaps, you know, if they want to make up their own mind and do it, then that's fine. But right now, they're children. They play soccer and baseball and skate and do all the regular things that children do.
Did the boys
this is
ever
my career.
Did the boys ever feel awkward that you are muscular and, you know, what generally was associated with kind of strength is associated with a kind of a toughness, generally speaking.
Well, I'm not tough. And no, they don't feel awkward. They like it. They think I look nice. Oh, Mommy, you look so nice.
So they can come up and feel your muscles?
Yeah.
If your husband wasn't here, I might.
This question is directed towards the single women. Although with civilian clothes on, it's very difficult to tell that you are professional bodybuilders. But once men find out that you are they intimidated not only by your physique, but at the fact that you are professional bodybuilders?
Who's the single ones? Okay. Good.
No, I've never run into that. I've run into the fact that, again, as Geraldo said, people tend to link strength with toughness. And there is a kind of a toughness, but it's a womanly toughness. It's an assertiveness.
Is that a tattoo I see on your
yes,
upper leg
mascot
there? Is that a bunny head?
Yes, it's a Playgirl bunny. I had lashes put on it.
Is there a story behind that tattoo?
No, just that I really wanted it. I always wanted a tattoo. And it's one of the things you always hear, you have to be drunk and it hurts so much and whatnot. And I decided that I was going to try and have it done, but I thought the large ones were a little vulgar. And so I had a small one put on, and I didn't want a male bunny on my knee because I'm a woman. So I had a female bunny put on.
Okay, hey, listen, I'm not arguing.
I wanted to know if bodybuilding affects childbearing. Like, is it hard to get pregnant? And, like, do you have to stop while you're pregnant to stop working out?
I can answer that. I know that they've had the children. I did an article, in-depth research article, on the effects of bodybuilding. And within the boundaries of what their body is capable of, say, for instance, if they're pregnant and they want to start, they shouldn't do anything more than what they were doing before. But afterwards, they can train very vigorously and rehabilitate their body quicker than any other type of exercise. Plus, the women who are bodybuilders already, who are pregnant, most of them train all the way through their pregnancy. One woman broke water in the gym while she was doing lat pull-downs. She was back in the gym 3 weeks later, and their bodies come back like that. They compete, they win trophies, they look incredible, so it's very healthy for them.
I don't want to dwell on this whole biological description here. That was quite vivid there, that one. But I heard that it affects, for instance, your menstrual cycle and other kind of biological functions. Is that not so, Eric?
Your body fat level goes down so low that you stop menstruating.
Let me say something about that, too. Medical research has found that that may not necessarily be the reason. They found that the limitation of calorie intake has more to do with amenorrhea than your body fat, because they found in models who may have a much higher level of body fat than almost any female athlete, they also suffer from amenorrhea, and there are several different forms. But it does have to do with your calorie intake.
And it does happen. Whatever the cause, female bodybuilders
It does happen.
Well, for me, I last year at the Miss Olympia, even though my body fat was low, as Carla said, which I didn't realize that was the reason, I was taking a lot of calories, so I had my period the same day of the contest. I've always do, so it hasn't affected me.
I just want to say you all look good, and I want to know, what does your workout consist of?
Actually, Janet's going to show us. So you want to start now? I tell you what, why don't we take a commercial break, and then you can demonstrate for us.
I thought you were going to work out.
Oh, no. I think I'd be, I wouldn't take my shirt off in this crowd. Give us 2 minutes. The world of women bodybuilders. The sex, the stigma, the steroids, and the sweat of it. We'll be right back. This is an inside look into the world of women bodybuilders, the sex, the sweat, the stigma, and the steroids. All that in a minute. I'm back. Just before Jenna Tech shows us a little bit about what she does to stay so fit, I wanted to show you Laura Crayable's new poster. Now, take a look at that. I mean, it's like, it can be banned in Boston. You see that? I mean, that's a body.
Geraldo, you know, one of the things, the nice thing about weight training, even when you're not in competition, is so that you can wear a thong bathing suit. I don't know about any of you guys, but it's a wonderful thing to be in.
Okay, let's go, Janet. Now, first of all, you are 32 years old, right?
Yes.
And you've been married for 10 years?
4 years.
4 years? I want to get 10 years. You've been bodybuilding for 10 years?
Yes.
Oh, I knew there was a 10 there someplace. Okay, now, what are we going to do? What aspect of your body are you going to work on?
All right, well, we have an incline bench here, so I thought we would actually work on some upper chest work, which is something that a lot of women could benefit from. It actually gives the illusion of a fuller, larger chest when you build the upper chest.
Not just an illusion, it's full.
Well, it is an illusion because it isn't the breast tissue that's larger, it's the muscle.
Oh, I see, the muscle behind it, so,
mm-hmm.
Yeah, sounds good to me.
And you could just stand beside me,
okay.
And if it gets difficult, you just get my elbows and push up.
Okay.
Here. I don't anticipate it being difficult.
Okay, right, hold this for me.
You just start at the outside of your chest, exhale as you push up, meet them slightly in the middle, inhale. And as you push up, try to think of the muscle you're training, which is the upper chest. It takes a while to concentrate. You get that muscle and body coordination going. But as you do, you try to squeeze at the top and really slowly on the down, stretch the muscle out.
Now you're using 25 pounds there.
Yeah, these
That's
are
a lot,
25 pounds in each hand. Well, it's not a lot for me, but for someone just starting out, I usually have my women start. I do mostly women who are really not bodybuilders. And they usually start out with 5s or 15s in each hand. And for most people that don't really want to build but tone, that's sufficient.
And how long do you do this?
Well, this is not the normal thing to do, to speak and just keep going. You would do it anywhere from 8 to 10 repetitions, maybe more, depending on the results that you want. And it would be controlled as far as how many repetitions and the weight that you use. You don't just keep going and talk. You should really be concentrating on what you're doing.
Right. Okay, show us one more.
Okay, I'll show you an arm exercise.
Okay.
A bicep exercise. That could be done seated and standing. We could stand and it would be,
okay.
It's called an alternate dumbbell curl. You start with the dumbbells hanging straight at your sides. Exhale as you bring the weight up. Inhale as the weight goes down. Always exhaling on the positive part of the movement, and the negative part is when you let the weight down.
Where am I supposed to breathe?
This is the hardest part. The exhaling is the hardest part.
I can't
part.
Dance either.
As you pull the weight up, exhale. When you let it down, inhale. The breathing coordination is the hardest part.
So on the hard part is when you
exhale. On the hard part, you're exhaling. And that's a rule almost for all exercises, when you're doing legs, etc. It helps you, and it helps you really complete the movement when you're exhaling.
Two quick questions. Number one, most women don't want big biceps.
Okay.
But on the other hand, a lot of women, especially when they get older, have extra skin underneath the arm.
That's tricep. And
so that's not this, then?
Well, this could firm the muscle. You don't need to use a lot of weight and build the muscle. A lightweight will firm the muscle. So for triceps, you could do something with maybe a little less weight. You would actually just extend it out, which would be a kickback. This is really too heavy even for me to do this particular movement. But the lighter the weight, the less the muscle growth. So you can control whether you grow or just get firm. So there's no real fear of getting extra large muscles that you don't want.
So any woman watching right now at home could buy a light, like a 5 pound little dumbbell.
5 to 8 pound dumbbells.
And do that exercise where you pick it up this way to take care of those wallies there.
Absolutely. You would just keep your upper arm, even with your back, and you just extend it out and down. It's a very small movement, but it's a real isolation movement, and that really does take care of that.
Okay. Now what about diet? What do you eat to look so fit?
I eat a lot, actually, but it's a lot of lean foods. I omit the fat from the diet, but I eat everything else. So I eat a lot of chicken, a lot of turkey, rices, potatoes. I stay away from refined flours, so anything made with flour, I avoid. That would mean pasta and breads. So I try to eat food that's in its most natural state.
Do you cook? Are you a homemaker?
Oh, I cook a lot. In fact, I just came out with a cookbook. It'll be out in about a month.
What's it called?
Janet Tech's Good Food Cookbook.
That's a catchy title.
Yes. I spend a lot of time in the kitchen because I eat a lot of food.
you would look at us and think that we starve ourselves to get this way, but actually that's kind of the old-fashioned way of getting lean. And the way to do it now is to feed your body a lot of food, but lean food, which ups the metabolism, which means you burn more calories at rest, which is the ideal situation.
You brought up starving yourself. There are three things. Okay, we can go. I think you've paid your dues here. Thank you very much. Janet. Janet brought up starving herself, and I have heard that rap that many of the girls go through eating disorders. I'm going to lay out the three negative things I'm going to talk about right now. I'm going to deal with three negative things. Number one is the frequency, or the how common eating disorders are or are not in the world of women bodybuilding. The second one is a relatively new one. I've heard that many women, or many bodybuilders generally, are going into the world of implants. They're getting the same kind of cosmetic surgery that many non-pros are getting. They're getting a breast implant because the body fat, it makes the breast small, or a calf implant because that's a hard muscle to work on. The third and last thing that we're going to talk about is the whole area of drug use, particularly steroids, as a way to chemically enhance. Those are the three raps that I hear about what you do. Diana, we'll start with you, and you can deal with eating disorders. How common is it? I've heard that many of the girls become anorexic in their desire for leanness. Is that not true?
I think that depends on the personality, really. It depends on the woman. I don't think that's true of all bodybuilders. But in having to diet so strictly, I think that it does happen, yes.
How do you prevent a young girl getting into bodybuilding from doing something as self-destructive as starving herself?
Well, first of all, I think that the people that are just getting into bodybuilding need good guidance. You know, you shouldn't just go into a gym and just start, you know, exercising and training and dieting without the guidance of a good trainer. You know, talking to your doctor first. There's a lot of things that you can do to help you burn body fat. You can take amino acids. There's an amino acid called L-carnitine that will help your body to convert its own fat to energy while you're doing aerobic exercise.
Could you give us an estimate of how common? Is it one out of every three girls that you know, one out of five? Every other one? I mean, can you give us any kind of number?
I really couldn't say.
I don't know.
No, I really don't either.
I've never met anyone. I think it's very uncommon.
I think today, really, we're far more aware of our general nutrition. You know, we've studied a lot more about it. We're far more educated about it. And it's not as prevalent in bodybuilding anymore.
Linda, let me ask you. You know, in the Miss America contest now, the women can wear what I used to call in high school, me and my friends, falsies.
Okay.
Are they making inroads into the area of bodybuilding as well?
Is it
like Miss America?
Well, it's, I would say, it's not like Miss America. It's based on a variety of different things. With bodybuilding, it's not who crosses the finish line first. So, of course, appearance is important. So I would say that that's important. That people look at that. That's one of the first things that they say is, well, female bodybuilders don't have breasts. So some women, like all women involved in sports, because it's not just female bodybuilders that don't have the, you know, breasts. It's track and gymnast. Yes.
Synchronized swimmers.
Yeah.
What's a shame about this breast issue, though, is female bodybuilders are usually seen portrayed in magazines in contest shape, which means they have very little body fat and hence very little breast tissue. The thing is, in the off season, when they have 10 to 15 pounds on them, they look normal, they look beautiful, they have normal sized breasts. You know, it's not something that anyone would look at and say, ooh, you know, but that is not usually what's in the magazines. There's nothing to compare it to, so they only see the contest ready athlete, which is not the norm, really.
Okay, we're talking about contest-ready athletes. Laura, don't you feel a certain degree of bitterness that you are forced sometimes to compete against women who are artificially enhancing their bodies with steroids?
The thing is, steroids doesn't make a bodybuilder. I know a lot of athletes in the gym, they train and they take steroids. It doesn't make them look any better. For me, it has a lot to do with your nutrition. Your genetics plays a great part. You can have if you haven't got the right genetics, you can take all the steroids in the world, it's not going to work. from the time I began, I had the right genetics. So I don't really worry. I mean, I compete against other girls that's taken steroids, and I've beaten them. So it doesn't bother me.
But isn't there some truth, Carla, to the statement that steroid use is still endemic in the world of women bodybuilding?
Oh, sure it is. Sure it is. Because in any athletic endeavor, the person who thinks that they have something that's going to give them an edge is going to utilize it. And I'm sure many people are aware of a little survey that was done amongst elite level athletes that if they had a little blue pill, but the blue pill guaranteed that you would win a gold medal, yet it would take 5 years off of your life in the long run, would you still take it? And approximately 70-80%, maybe more, said yes.
Let's take a break. The world of women bodybuilding on Focus.
I was wondering what other sports you were interested in, and perhaps sports would enhance your muscular tone.
Are you interested in anything else? Go ahead. Linda?
I've been involved in sports for about 18 years. I started at 10, and I've been involved in cheerleading. I ran track in high school, in college, and I was a professional cheerleader with the USFL for 2 years, Michigan Panthers. So that all contributed to my body because the track and field, I was a sprinter, gave me the strong legs, and then I was involved in gymnastics with the cheerleading, which gave me a strong upper body. And when I first started, I only started working with the weights maybe about 2 months and then competed in my first show.
I'd like to know how much you all weigh.
Well, so personal. Well, if they don't mind telling us. All right, what's up with Carla on the left?
5'3", 133.
5'3", 133. So would you describe yourself as, you know, solidly built?
Well, then? Let's put it this way. I'm at 10.5% body fat, and the average is about 23.
The average woman.
Mm-hmm. Right.
It's one quarter of her body is fat. Yours is only 10%. I got you. Yeah, Laura.
I'm 5'4", and I'm 150.
150?
Uh-huh.
Wow. You don't look it at all.
And I have about 9%.
You must have iron bones.
I have about between 8%, about 8%, 7-8% body fat.
Geraldo, one thing you have to understand, muscle is so much denser than fat, and that women who add... Women are
Janice
not accustomed to having that much muscle. We're so tuned into, we're at the scale all the time. Most of us don't really look at the scale that much. We mm-hmm. look in the mirror, because when you have that dense muscle, it's very compact. Even though it weighs more, it keeps you in. I weigh like 123, and these are size 3 jeans. So last time I was 123 in college, I was wearing a size 9. So there's okay. a big difference between muscle and fat.
We're still curious, though. Linda?
I'm 5'5", and I weigh 158 pounds.
158.
Yes.
That's what I weigh.
Really? Yeah.
Really?
158.
Yeah, Ken Cooper, are you sure you're not intimidated?
No.
It sounds amazing.
I tell you. Go ahead, Erica.
I'm 5'8", and I weigh 145.
That's lovely. Janet?
5'2", 120.
And Diana?
I'm 5'7", and I weigh 148.
148. You just, I mean, it's so true what Carol Ann said. It just, it doesn't look it at all. Come on. Oh, I did ask you? Okay. Carolyn,
yeah.
Is it still the world of bodybuilding a man's world? By that I mean, is the ideal of the winner of the competition still what the men dictated is?
Until today, I would say yes, because of your show.
Thank you. Always been a social reformer.
It definitely has been. I mean, from its inception, the very first Miss Olympia, the whole division of the troops came between, do we have muscular or do we have what they considered feminine? But just even as you introduced in your show, at one point you said this was a man's, when is it going to be? And I think we're sort of the pioneers where we say this is what a woman's idea of femininity is. We've never really stepped out and established our own identity, what we have found to be our bodies capable of, and what we say this is the feminine ideal. It has been in the past what men find attractive or between cultures. So I think we're in an age now where women are claiming their own identity.
Who's, is it Lydia down there? Yes. Aren't you a judge in The International Federation of Bodybuilding?
Yes, and I used to compete with Carla, so I started from the beginning, and now I'm on the other side, so.
It would seem to me, now I don't want to be judgmental, I don't know much about it, I just, I'm a casual worker outer just to stay in shape, but it would seem to me that if the judges stopped giving the awards to the really bulky women or men, for that matter, there would be less of a temptation to use the little blue pill, to use the steroid, the artificial chemical enhancement, if there was a slightly more, I don't know, is feminine look? I don't know. You understand what I'm trying to say?
Yeah,
isn't it your fault as a judge that people use steroids?
No, I would not. No, not at all.
Not that I want to put you on the spot or anything.
No. Everybody is responsible for any action that they take, and I think that any woman who wants to take drugs, it is her decision. No one's forcing it down her throat. Any man who takes drugs, it's his decision. And I as a judge, men as a judge, we see what's on stage. And as every contest has evolved, I mean, starting with, Ms. Olympia ages ago with Rachel McClish up to today, it's evolved. If you stay within one parameter and stay with the way we judge, say, 10 years ago, the sport in one sense has not evolved. What we're seeing now is controversy because how far are we going to let it go? And that's what everybody's talking about. Okay, we have muscular women from, a slender version to a very muscular version. What we're judging on stage on that particular day is a complete, and that package has changed in its total look. If a woman has been training for 2 years, her body will look one way. If she's been training for 10 years, the degree of density in that muscle will look different. The judges are not sitting there all the time saying, this is what I want. Sometimes we're being told by powers above that.
Okay, before we get into the powers above, isn't it a fact that you can pretty much tell a woman who's on steroids, doesn't that chemical have a unique changing impact by bulking the muscles and you're making the face kind of squarish look?
It has an absolute effect. I mean, if you're anybody who has been in a gym as long as many of these women have, as I have, you see transformations overnight, and it's frightening. It's something I obviously wouldn't recommend to other people, but you see it on stage, and if they have not been disqualified, you do not have a right not to judge them. You are supposed to judge what you see, and it's the IFBB's responsibility to and what they've been trying to do.
Would you say that they're dropping the ball and not living up to their responsibility, that steroid use is still rampant? To the great disadvantage of honest women like we have on our stage who don't use steroids and have to compete against those that are synthetically puffing themselves up?
Well, it's always a conflict because the magazines promote one image, the governing body tries to promote another image, and they're in constant conflict because the contests depend on audience, the audience depends on the competitors. The competitors depend on the audience's desire for a certain muscularity to keep their careers going. And where do these women go after the contest? If there's no audience there,
that's a good question. That's the last one. I'm very interested. Now, you mentioned, I just want to change the subject very slightly to leave for the commercial break on a slightly up note. Lydia talked about what you see in the gym every day. Well, in my gym that I work at Ken, I see this poster of your mom. As you can see, it's quite it's great. I mean, the musculature and all that, and you can be very aesthetic about it, but it's also a lovely woman in a bikini. How do you react when guys in the gym come up to you and say, hey, your mom, hey, give you a kind of elbow? How do you feel about that?
I had not really much in the gym. I've had a lot of it when I was in high school.
And what do you say?
To me, it's, she's my mom, and I'll always look at her that way. And, I'm proud of her and what she does. But they always say, well, that's great, your mom, your mom's a professional bodybuilder, she can probably kick your butt and this and that. I said, no, my mom's my mom, whether she's bigger than I am or more toned or whatever, it makes
But
no
it was
difference.
Remarkable that you were always home by 11 o'clock in high school. Let's take a break. Come back in 2 minutes. The world of women and barbells, babes and barbells.
Someone mentioned it doesn't matter how old you are to start, but a senior citizen like me is concerned about the shrinkage of the skin possibility.
It actually works. What happens is as you develop muscle, and you can develop muscle at your age, we would definitely have to take a look at what you're eating too, because you would obviously have to increase the protein intake in your diet.
Go like this, go like this.
No, in fact, now. Now they're actually having weight training programs for senior citizens because one of the very positive benefits is it inhibits the development of osteoporosis in women because it helps, you know, keep your bones strong. So it's very recommended, and it does help tighten your skin too when you start adding muscle. So it's good for you.
Was it you, Carla, who was were threatened by a rapist, or you were a victim of crime? Who was that? Who started bodybuilding? Was that you, Carla?
Yeah, I'm a rape survivor.
You are, really?
Yeah.
And did you get into this for that reason, for fitness, but also self-defense?
Well, actually, it started out as I got into it because I've always liked muscles on men. So I figured, well, maybe I'd like them on me, too. But as I got into it, I realized how good it made me feel about reclaiming my own personal power and my strength. And so I had inside of me, there was a personal thing I was gaining that I found no other way to reclaim. And it was really very wonderful.
I understand how you mean that psychologically, regaining a certain confidence, but do you also physically, when you walk around the street, feel more confident?
Well, absolutely, because you know you're strong, and just putting that out, you know, I brought this so I could maybe take my jacket off, not like I can compare to these world champions here, but anyway, it's like if I'm walking on the street, and normally guys see a little 5'2" blonde, you know, and they might even, like, give you some negative comments or whatever. If I just walk and sort of walk bigger, and they see some arms or something, they tend to back off, and I don't feel myself as subject. Obviously, I'm not going to be foolish and walk down a dark alley, but somehow you put out something different, a lot more self-confidence, more confidence in your own personal strength,
and
it helps.
You have great biceps there. You want to?
Oh, thank you.
Seeing the Pumping Iron movies with Carla and Rachel McLish. Are there any plans for any of those, and has it evolved since those first Pumping Iron movies?
There have been several things. There have been TV programs. We just got finished filming something called Lady Flex, which is going to be taken to Cannes to be sold as a TV pilot for a women's show. And everywhere you look on TV now, whereas before Pumping Iron 2 was a herald in its time, now you've got women in commercials. You've got that great hotel commercial where it says, you know, the woman sitting there going, yeah, pump up, for a personal trainer in a hotel. It's all over the place now, but now it's more spread out. It's in everything as opposed to being just movies.
It really has come out of the sweaty gym on the alleyway to break into mainstream society.
I'd like to ask the audience a question. How many of you out there like the look of what we do or have a respect for what we do?
Well, indicate by your applause. Right. Stop. The other side of the coin, you know, the two sides of every story. How many, indicate also by your applause, how many of you feel that the look of a woman bodybuilder is not feminine? Indicate by your applause. You do? Why?
I guess I have old-fashioned ideas.
We're going to more from you in 2 minutes. I've got to take a break. If you'd like to be part of our live studio audience, then write us at Geraldo Tickets, 524 West 57th Street, New York, New York, 10019. Or you can call us, 212-265-1283.
Close-lit neighbors on what used to be a quiet one-way street have seen their block party end in a world of hate when the murderer turns out to be your neighbor on the next edition of Geraldo.
Commercial break. I got some representatives of the various factions. We were talking to you. You said you didn't like it. Why? What don't you like about the look?
Well, I have to preface it by saying I have enormous respect and admiration for these women. I think it takes tremendous discipline. I hate working out. I'd like to hire someone to work out for me. However, I think they look better in clothes.
I think they look wonderful in clothes, but it's hard work.
And do you think that the muscle look is not for ladies then?
To me, femininity is bespoken by a certain amount of softness. And when I see them flexing their muscles, though, I have great respect for their endurance and continuing interest in this. To me, when I see the biceps and the triceps, it's a turnoff.
Okay, let me get the other side of the story. I'm going to get the other side of the story. I'm going to get the other side of the story right now.
I think it's wonderful. I just wondered if I tried to do it now, would I get the same results?
I'm sure you will.
I think they look terrific. And I'd just like to know a little bit more about their diet and their regimen to go along with it.
Buy Janet's cookbook.
They all look wonderful. They're very beautiful and gorgeous women.
I think they look great, but I'd like to ask Carolyn. You said you started when you were 39.
Yes.
How old are you now?
43.
Carolyn, where is the sport bodybuilding? In what direction is it going in women's bodybuilding?
That is such a good question. We'll have everybody wanting to respond to it. But what I see for it, my own vision as a journalist and interviewing everyone, is it's going to be in the hands of the women. That ultimately the women will decide how muscular they can be and still be women. Who knows what our bodies are capable of? There's no end to it. Right now we're heading out across the ocean. We don't know if we're going to go over the edge or our dragons are going to eat us up, or we're going to just become a new archetype for the women that's never been done before in the history of the world. So my vision is a sport of the women, by the women, and for the women.
Okay.
I know some of you were already involved in sports, but I wanted to ask, like, did you start out with mediocre bodies? How long did it take before the muscles, you know, these fabulous muscles start to develop? Could you really see them, you know, coming up?
Somehow I doubt they started with mediocre bodies. I mean, I know I'm on the limb when I say that, but...
I started out with a very thin body. I was at one point anorexic, I believe.
Really?
Yeah. I started out at 108 pounds when my son was only two. I was working in gyms, and I just watched my body grow. It's just fascinating to watch your body change like that. To me, bodybuilding is an art form. And as far as I'm concerned, I'm sitting here in front of you trying to show you or help you see bodybuilding from an artist's viewpoint. And we're also here, I think all of us, because we're in this sport for one of the major reasons I believe all of us are in it, is to make a difference in your lives.
You have. I like to think that this program does more than just entertain you for 60 minutes. I hope that we can learn something from it. Carla, what's the biggest stereotype that you hope that we have helped overcome here today?
I think just that their understanding, the general understanding of what the women are trying to do and the image they're trying to project. We look at female, what I was going to say to you is we look at gymnasts and we don't see just muscles, but gymnasts are as muscular as the women up here, they're just in a smaller frame.
Erica, same question.
Yes, I think that anybody can become a bodybuilder, any woman. I think it's good for all women, and I hope that women watching us today have learned something from us and will go to the gym and work on themselves.
Thank you, ladies. Thank you, our studio audience and you folks at home. Thank you very much for watching. We'll see you next time. Where are you? Bye-bye.